fellow Americans, stand by for news and, as always, the rest of the story. Although, goodness gracious me, you're going to have to write your own conclusion to this one. Have you seen the papers? Oh, believe me, it's everywhere. I'll swear we're reaching what you might call POTUS Bimbo Eruptus critical mass, Dalliance Devotee. The point at which mathematically it requires less time and effort to find out who our president hasn't hit on than who he has. We can run the probe. Oops, bad word. We can run the investigation out of a new cabinet-level position, Secretary of Secretaries. Appropriately, SOS for short. Yes, dear listener, step right up and snap the bra of Kathleen Willey, the latest that we know of to get herself ensnared in a Clinton clinch. Settle back and let's dip into a little tale, so to speak. 1993, story goes, our Mr. Bill spots Kathy in the Oval Office, squires her to a little hideaway to investigate her oval orifice. She emerges a while later, looking like she'd been at ground zero in a Clarence Thomas chicken choker at the corner Bijou, having had everything on her but a disinfectant. Lipstick smeared to all four compass points, coolio hair, clothes on side saddle, whistling hail to the Jeep, and grinning like she'd just fallen into the Vaseline vat at the Y'all Come Back Sausage Factory. Oh, wait a minute. Wait a minute. You say you can't grin and whistle at the same time?
No.
Sure you can. Just turn that frown upside down and blow. Page two.
Yeah.
Well, the rest of the story, Fidelity fan, another lady, an F-O-K, that's a friend of Kathy's, and don't pronounce that little acronym if you want to stay on the air. Anyway, a friend of Kathy's named Linda Tripp, used to work with her at the White House, she's told Newsweek that this little dalliance between Ms. Willey and, well, Mr. Willey, I guess you might say, was not, and underline that, not any sort of harassment. No, siree, consensual. So, no help for the Paula Jones issue, I suppose. It does add another layer to the morass in which our beloved commander-in-chief seems to be slowly sinking, though, doesn't it? And hasn't that been the problem all along? Bill Clinton and morass?
Shut up.
Paul Harvey, good day.
San Francisco goes into Carolina and beats up on the Panthers 34-21. Niners get a good game from the human concussion, Steve Young, who ran for one touchdown, threw for another. Panthers linebacker Lamar Lathan couldn't believe his team's performance.
I think this is the first time that I can honestly say, and I always say this after the game, a team, what we did out there, the team was more physical than us tonight.
Okay. Sound like Mitch Blood Green
from the courthouse.
Yeah. God, 49ers now 4-1.
Cow.
New York Giants.
Hey, if I get on a jury, Bernie,
yeah,
I'll have you cover the trial.
Yeah.
Because I'm not going to be able to report on the trial, obviously.
Right.
Probably I wouldn't. I wouldn't blurt something out. Well, no, if they told me not to, I wouldn't.
Oh, of course not.
Right.
Play by the rules.
Yeah, sure.
Well, what time do you have to be down there today?
9:00.
What time's that hot dog stand open?
Well, how would I know?
A lot of them have breakfast sausages, you know.
No. This is a picture, and I could just as easily have been walking by a liquor store.
But you weren't.
Well, the hot dog stand is on the corner there.
Why are you eyeing the Stanford
sign? I got sunglasses on. How can you tell what I'm eyeing? I'm not eyeing anything.
Well, why do you have your wallet out?
That's not my wallet. I don't carry a wallet. That's my cell phone.
Call for your ATM card.
New York Giants rookie running back Tiki Barber out for a couple of weeks, so Tyrone Wheatley will start Sunday against the Cowboys. Wheatley's an easygoing, pleasant chap who shared his philosophy of running with a group of school kids.
I respect no one, man. Hell, I mean, if I'm trying to go where I'm trying to go and you're in my way, I got to put you down, and that's just the way I take it.
Hey, Dad. NFL needs more attitudes like that.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. Thank you, Tyrone. Baseball playoffs are here. They begin today.
All right.
Astros and Braves in Atlanta. Braves, of course, the huge favorite there, but Astros manager Larry Durker is all fired up.
You know, it's a game. You go out there and play, and we think we've got a chance.
Well, not exactly Newt Rockne, but apparently that'll do for the Astros.
Well,
1:07 Eastern time, first pitch there.
He's not wrong about it, is he?
No, he's not.
Well, what do you want?
Oh, great. I'll be sitting down there on jury duty, and they're going to have baseball games on.
That's right.
That's great.
Adding to the burden here.
Yeah.
Right.
Giants and Marlins will be in Florida. That's a 4:07 Eastern time first pitch.
Maybe the hot dog guy have the TV set up.
That will be fine. Most of them do have those little things.
Yeah, they do.
So you can have lunch while you're watching a game.
No. There's no lunch. What's about the lunch?
Well, quick lunch. They go to lunch from, what'd you say, from 12 to 2 or 1
to 2? And, you know, I try to be cooperative with these, with the photographers and these other people. I mean, why not? But I wasn't buying a hot dog. I was walking by it. How can I help that?
How ironic.
And what do they do? You try to cooperate, what do? They hose you.
Well, it appears that way.
They've trapped you.
Yes, they did. It's actually now how Princess Diana must have felt.
Absolutely.
Driven to her death, and I'm being driven to... Well,
if suicide? Maybe?
Well, what, Bernie?
Keep hope alive.
Tonight, it's the Indians and Yankees in the Bronx. You'll be able to watch that if you all finish your jury duty by then.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right. Yankee manager Joe Torre was asked for his starting lineup.
Reigns, Jeter, O'Neill, Williams, Martinez, Curtis, Boggs, Girardi, Sanchez.
All right. Right. In case you missed any of the starters, here's Torre again.
Reigns, Jeter.
No. We don't want to hear the starters again. Well, some people like to fill out their scorecard early.
Well, they can watch tonight.
While others do other things during the day.
In fulfilling your civic duty, part of the deal shouldn't be that you're held up to public ridicule.
Right.
As being portrayed in the newspaper this morning as a juror reject.
Or
but any moron can get on a jury.
Or subjected to ambush photography, for crying out loud.
By the paparazzi.
That shows you, you know, in an area that you didn't want to be seen in.
No, I mean, no.
You know they knew that.
They listen.
Of course they listen.
The U.S. Open hot dog history.
I'm walking by a hot dog stand.
Yeah, I see that.
Tell me about it.
Well, that's
where they could have shot you anywhere, I meant.
Mm-hmm. Well, no, they can't see the car behind. I had just gotten out of the car, mm-hmm. and I was in Rocco's to the left of me there, and he and I are walking in the courtroom.
Why
did courthouse.
They get you as you were emerging from the car before you reach that particular point where they would see you staring?
They were all over taking pictures of Mike Tyson and Mitch Green. So they didn't spot the I'm in until I was unfortunately standing right next to the hot dog stand.
Delicious beef frankfurters.
Silvio.
Yes, Mickey.
How you call your lover boy?
Come here, lover boy.
And if he doesn't answer?
Oh, lover boy.
And if he still doesn't answer?
I simply say, Nimbus in the morning.
Don't miss the intensity, attitude, freshness, and excitement. Of the 1999 U.S.
I don't know how I did this,
yeah.
But I've lost 2 cantaloupe in my apartment. I mean, how does a guy lose? Have you ever lost food? I don't understand it. How I could lose 2 cantaloupe somewhere?
What, did you put them in the refrigerator?
No, I checked it. That's the first place I checked. I've checked there and under my laundry.
Why would you check in your laundry?
Well, because I have it piled up here, and you know, some could have got under there.
All right, let's say you take a long drive one night out into the country all by yourself. Mm-hmm. And while you're sitting there looking at the stars, a spacecraft lands right in front of your automobile. Aliens emerge, grab you, and take you away for 12 months, performing bizarre experiments on you.
Ooh,
the good news is, when they finally bring you back, you can at least be sure your car will start. They happen to have the amazing new X-Side Select Orbital Battery. Why? Well, because unlike conventional batteries, they are built with flat plates.
The rich situation behind them closed doors is fine with me.
That's okay.
And he's introduced a bill to end...
As long as he's not putting his weenie in my little butt.
That's fine. I don't want that.
Well, then it wouldn't be consensual.
No, it wouldn't.
And that's the kind of thing that would not be covered here in this bill that he's introduced to end criminal prosecution of troops who engage in adultery or other consensual sex.
Now,
Congressman Frank said the Kelly Flynn and Joe Ralston cases have prompted him, you know, to get busy.
If we do not want Kelly Flynn...
Well, because I think I'm excited with Bernard on it.
He sounds like he has something in his mouth, too, when he talks.
I don't.
Like he's looking up at you and trying to talk, you know?
That would be fine.
Now we don't need to. No. We don't need to go here.
That's fine. That's fine, Barney. Just go ahead.
Congressman Frank,
we'll talk afterwards.
Don't laugh at him. That just encourages him.
I am sorry.
How is that helpful?
It's not. I'll turn my mic.
No, we've made our point here. This is not uplifting or enlightening.
Not at all.
Congressman Frank said the military would still be free to discipline troops for certain consensual behavior.
To make it clear, this is not an effort to undermine the military's ability to prevent fraternization or other things that undermine good order and discipline. Obviously, the military is different than the rest of society.
Yes, we are aware of that.
But that's no basis for making things criminal.
No, it's not.
Right. We'll continue this later. Just go ahead.
No, it's not.
It's not.
It's been long.
It's been 4 minutes after we are.
That's fine, Congressman. Currently, adultery in the military can be punishable by a prison sentence.
It's a naked thing.
But he said, if there's still activity that underlines order and discipline, then that would continue to be banished.
All right, here now, weighing in on all of this properly is Bo Deal. Good morning, Mr. Deal.
Good morning, Don.
Great. I wasn't
going to call up, but I've been listening to the cut all morning with Elmer Fudd there, and I'm very... Let me tell you something. He's gargling with some spermazole in his mouth.
Oh, come on here, but we don't need
all for.
No, that's not what we're looking for.
That's
here.
Not uplifting.
What has he got in his mouth?
No. Well, we don't know. Okay. It doesn't. What difference does it make?
I'm very serious. This cut, that's all. America has to listen to this mumble mouth mother.
That will be fine. Just get rid of him. Get rid of him. Get rid of him.
Can't help himself.
Just get rid of him. He can't help himself. Get rid of him.
Bo, come on, Bo.
Bo, come back to us. All right, here now on the I Miss the Morning program, a man who is. Well, pretty much not happening anymore. Rush Limbaugh. Good morning, Rush.
My friends, with assorted and sundry dittos from CIN, the Conservative Intolerance Network, it is I, your hefty, hidebound homeboy, Rush Limbaugh, coming to you today from the set of Homo Improvement, a new do-it-yourself sitcom where you build a closet, come out of it, and bring your ratings-challenged program into the land of the 70 share.
Well.
And speaking of flannel shirts, tongue in groove, and television comedy, I am amazed and astonished to hear that not only is the titled character of the Disney ABC comedy Ellen coming out as a lesbian, the very star of the show herself is an avowed, proud, card-carrying sister of Sappho. Here's another shocker. The Arabs and Jews don't get along. Really, was there anyone who expected Ms. DeGeneres to say, I'm not a lesbian, but I play one on TV?
Well.
One wonders what Walt Disney would think if someone at the Magic Kingdom inadvertently unplugged the freezer and he thawed out long enough to see what his legacy had degenerist to. Hey, all I intended was a mouse and a roller coaster. Where the hell did all these dykes come from? Actually, the real surprise is how little I care about all of this. You see, the kinder, gentler Rush believes that far too much is made of sexuality. After all, it's such a subjective topic. Who's to say what qualifies as social aberrance? In Alabama, a man is considered a queer if he likes women more than football. I've come to terms with the fact that there can be two women sharing the same foxhole, especially in the age of don't ask, don't tell. However, as for me, I'd rather cover myself in a purple tablecloth and strap on a pair of running shoes than have some gay beau peeping up my heaven's gate. And for the record, any self-respecting lesbian wouldn't be caught dead in a pair of Nikes. The tongues aren't long enough. If Ellen could use the issue of her sexual preference to gain a more favorable position on the Nielsen list, why can't Bubba use what God has given him to do the same with his approval ratings? Let's view the facts. Even though he has a tendency to drop them around his ankles now and again, he prefers to wear pants. He's well known for his prowess at munching. He's fat, sports an ugly haircut, and, of course, has an abnormal sexual obsession with women. Why, Bill Clinton is the quintessential lesbian!
Read a little item about Michael Kennedy, who ain't exactly the model for celibacy. Though his uncle treats a car like a submarine, he never dunked a girl under 17. Mike said, hey, Ted, take a walk on the child side. He said, Uncle, try the juvenile side. Then there's a story about Mikey's brother, Joe, whose ex-wife thinks he's an evil so-and-so. He says, with married life, starts to get dull. Just find another babe, get the Pope to annul. He said, hey, babe, take a walk on the goodbye side. Get lost, babe. Here's a kick for your backside, and the Kennedy girls sing. Frank Gifford, the philandering husband to Kathy Lee, went cruising by himself for an extra marital spray. Right in the middle of hidden camera week, Giff showed up in a video, even Regis freaked. Hey, Giff, you walking on the senile side. Better get used to being on that exile side. Then there was that B-52 pilot. Took the military code about adultery and defiled it. It says you face court-martial if you act like a whore. She never should have opened up her Bombay doors. Hey, babe, there goes your fly-by side. Hey, Lieutenant, better zip up that fly side. Cause way back when I was the governor, wasn't happy unless I had a babe and I was loving her. BBD is around my knees, asked Paula to kiss it. I even said, please. I said, hey, babe, take a walk on the wild side. I said, hey, sugar beet, walk on that testify side. Manaka knees go. Do it, 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 do it. Well, you're not going to do it. Well, let me blow this.
And I said, why is it necessary to disparage America's anchorman?
Ooh, that's a slam.
Yeah. When you want me to promote something you've done.
So, it's none of this. It's gratuitous.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
So he chuckled, and he's off to Mongolia.
Yeah. Good. Get out.
And I'll look at his thing.
Or Colombia.
Or Colombia.
Or Missouri.
Or Missouri. We're not sure.
Namibia. We don't know what the hell he said.
We don't know where the hell he's going.
Just go.
He may just be going it. Home to Montana.
And could be going back to Montana.
Montana.
Anyway, he's going somewhere.
The potential for trouble from Bertha forced President Clinton to cancel a political trip to Florida this evening. Here in New York, our meteorologist and resident hurricane expert is Joe Witte, and he's tracking what now appears to be a wobble.
I'm a in the morning.
A lot of people here at the radio station has already visited Dr. Joseph Delarusso at the New Jersey Ice. Here now, late breaking developments just in to the IMUS in Washington Network newsroom.
I'm David Brinkley of this program and the one that bears my name, Sundays, feeling much improved since having my gizzard worked on recently. Wow. Thank you. Joined, as always, by our regulars who've been with me for years now, week in, week out, whose names escape me at the moment. Rush somebody, a fella called Cronkite, and some anus, I believe.
No, that's IMUS in charge of the Washington Bureau.
Sorry, oversight, my fault. Feel terrible about it.
Sure.
Now the news. Controversy compounded at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue, where it's just been announced that the Clinton administration has fired the entire White House travel office staff again and is turning over travel arrangements for the press corps to the Islamic Jihad. The concept, improve relations with the Islamic world and blunt media criticism.
Yeah.
Mr. Clinton spoke to reporters a short time ago.
Hey, baby, you want to go out?
Not right now, sugar. Good morning. Hillary and I have just fired the travel office, and we're telling you now up front to avoid humiliating questions later.
Yeah.
We're buying a plane for y'all to travel on from Sheikh Omar Abdel Rahman's organization so that you'll all get on it, see? And if all goes according to plan, they'll blow it up at about 32,000 feet over New Hampshire, and y'all will get off my back. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Come here, Daddy. Oh, you look so good.
Controversial, perhaps, but effective in muting press criticism, no doubt. Chet?
Chet, Mr. Huntley passed away, Mr. Franklin.
Of course he did. I knew that. Don't know what's wrong with me. My condolences to his family.
Meantime, news of another travel problem bedeviling the administration. The widely traveled energy secretary, Hazel, I want my upgrade O'Leary, is described by columnist William Sapphire today as a congenital
Yeah?
Flyer. President Clinton reportedly wants to punch Sapphire in the nose, but has faxed a letter to boxer Mike Tyson asking him to do it for him, explaining that if he, the president, did it, it could damage him politically.
From our media desk, Cosmopolitan Magazine has introduced its new editor-publisher, who steps into the shoes vacated by original Cosmo girl, Helen Gurley Brown. The new Cosmogul was, until 24 hours ago, a resident of a Bosnian concentration camp near the town of Tuzla, and, in the words of a Cosmo press release, a dead ringer for Ms. Brown herself, who, during her long years of service, had had her face and body sculpted to the point that at age 73, she looked like a 5-foot tall Slim Jim, whose purchase date expired simultaneously with the first flight of the Wright brothers.
And now a closing thought. Hillary Rodham Clinton, defending herself against mounting criticism, credits her mother for much of her toughness, saying Mom always told her, don't give in to bullies. I wonder, what did Bill's mother ever tell him not to give in to? Anything? Apparently not.
Go, baby.
The other series, Seattle wins in Phoenix in overtime. That series tied at 2 games apiece. But despite the loss, the Suns will come out tomorrow. Bet your bottom dollar that tomorrow they'll be Suns. That game would have gone to a second overtime, but it wasn't tied after the first OT.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
One other NBA note, Rookie of the Year, Allen Iverson of the Philadelphia 76ers, who said he wasn't concerned even if the media didn't vote for him.
In my heart, you know, I knew who the Rookie of the Year was, but it wasn't up to me to decide that.
Mm-hmm.
Who says you can't talk after you smoke crack?
When life takes a sip,
send a letter of support to O.J. Simpson, press 1 now. If you have an important lead regarding the O.J. Simpson case, press 2 now. If you are an expert in a field relating to the Simpson case, or have some idea about how we can explain away any portion of the mountain of evidence that points directly to O.J., especially that f***ing bloody glove, press 3 now. If you happen to be an O.J. Simpson lookalike and would like to pick up an easy 50, 60 G's, press 4 now. Following are additional O.J. Simpson case options. If you, as we, agree that the intimacy of the relationship between O.J. and A.C. Cowlings suggests A.C. should add the term DC to his name, press 6 followed by 9. If you think after watching her in action that being married to Marcia Clark would make you put a gun in your mouth, press Jesus now. If it's your opinion that Ms. Clark's David Gergen-esque sidekick, the goofball with the beard, thinks Roe versus Wade are river crossing alternatives, press idiot now. If you fervently wish that the next door OJ would knock on would be the one to Mick Jagger's dressing room, press 86. By pressing star 1, star 2, or star 3, please indicate your preference of who should play O.J. in made-for-TV movies. Wesley Snipes, James Earl Jones, or Tupac Shakur. A reminder for Mr. Shapiro. If you yourself are seeking legal representation or have just witnessed a possible whiplash auto accident, a fall in a bathtub, or similar actionable mishap, press 7, then 11 now. Thank you for your call.
CBS Radio, all rights reserved. Imus in the Morning is a presentation of WFAN and Westwood One Entertainment, and I demand a recount.
This concludes the entertainment and revenue-generating portion of your broadcast day. We now return you to the rest of your local programming schedule, an indecipherable embarrassment of broadcasting incompetence that compelled the station to subscribe to the Imus in the Morning program in the first place. The entertainment and revenue-generating portion of the broadcast day, the Imus in the Morning program, will resume tomorrow morning. Check your local listings for time and schedule.
Sports Radio 66, WFAN New York, an Infinity Broadcasting Station. WFAN 2020 Sports.
Good morning, it's 10 o'clock. I'm Joe Tolleson. Mets pick up a game.
1027 WNEW.
Hey, man.
All right, sir.
You ever do this? Take a half bottle of Viagra on top of a handful of X-Lax? It's great. You know whether you're coming or going. Hey, did I hear CBS is going to merge with Viacom?
Yes.
That wouldn't positively impact upon the IMAS portfolio, would it? Man, with Hillary Man on them cattle futures, ain't nothing compared to the haul you're going to make off that turkey radio show of yours. With you part of CBS and Nickelodeon, how long before you make a guest appearance on Angry Beavers? That's one of them cartoon shows on Nick Jr., by the way, not a room full of my brother's Jane Doe's. Hey, did you hear brother and sister-in-law bought themselves another little white house up there in Westchester?
Heard of.
Just a $1.7 million fixer-upper opportunity in Chappaqua. I think they're planning on having a little housewarming deal. They're going to invite the FBI over for a barbecue and then not let Janet Reno know anything about it. Boy, that's not a woman you want to have. Hey, you hear Alan Funt passed away?
Yes, I did.
I don't know, but after a 50-year career setting up people, catching them on film, I don't think I'll feel all that comfortable going to his funeral, know what I mean? Not out of the question to be right in the middle of paying your respects and old Alan pops out in the box smiling, you know, carrying the camera. I mean, I could do with that. Hey, I gotta go, man. I'm starting to peak. I took some mescaline and some Benzedrine before, and I'm speeding so bad my hallucinations are being preceded by coming attractions.
Tony Gwynn says Leiter has evolved as a pitcher.
When he was with the Marlins, everything was hard, but now we weren't supposed to have the play, so now he's a completely different guy.
Anyone knows pitchers? Tony Gwynn.
He's a great guy. You should see the heat on some of the things he throws. Boy, I'll tell you, it makes you say, geez, look at that thing go, huh? Personally, he's one heck of a good guy, too. Got one of the coolest bowling bags in the league. We stay in touch. We like to email each other throughout the year. Both big fans of Asleep at the Wheel.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
Friday night, out on a boat, in the lake, fishing.
And sure.
Hey, it's Dwight Yoakam on that.
Imus in the Morning. Sports Radio 66, WFAN.
General George S. Patton, Jr. At ease, as you were. I have summoned you people here this morning for a CIB, Classified Informational Briefing. Since all of you have top security clearances, I am able to convey this material to you. Let's get on with it. Private, give me a corporate rage solution on the light bank up there and roll out the overhead projector.
Sir, yes, sir.
Cease fire. Cease fire.
Sir, the private reports, lights out, sir.
Fine, Jesus. All right, give me the projector and slide one. Can anybody identify the facility shown here? Yes, you in the back.
Sir, that appears to be a satellite photograph of the top secret biological and chemical warfare research station located at Plum Island, New York, sir.
Exactly, soldier. Very good. And what is this installation known for, primarily?
Sir, for developing the most hideous, repulsive, and repugnant agents of infectious diseases known to man, sir. Stuff that if you touched it, your pecker would instantly fall off, sir, screaming.
I don't think we require that level of detail, Private, but you are quite correct. Which brings me to today's issue. There has been an accident at Plum Island.
Oh, my God!
At ease. Recently, a test tube containing genetically engineered material that appalled even these veteran scientists was dropped and broken. The bacteria, grown in a medium of pond scum and regurgitated pig slop, escaped, found its way to Boston, Massachusetts, where, through clever mutation, it became the new management and staff of radio station WEEI.
But, sir, those bacteria, like, live out their entire life cycles and breed and all of that stuff inside, like, people's colons and stuff, sir.
Right again. That, regrettably, is what has taken over station WEEI, soldier. Germs. Germs that live, copulate, and die in These are the organisms we now know who go under such names as, for the sake of example, Jason Wolf, WEEI's program director, and Tom Baker, WEEI's general manager, to identify just two of many now causing this particular broadcast facility's morbid decomposition. While there are significant others, it is these two, we believe, who are principally responsible for the debacle under which Imus in the Morning was allowed to be lost to rival FM Talk 96.9
had approximately twice the money realized at WEEI. Yeah. And it is these two, primarily, who have since played a desperate cover-their-ass game, trying to portray the IMUS radio program, America's single most successful ever, as ratings and revenue division. Yeah. Well, boys, we have all dealt with germs before, and we will all deal with germs again. Yeah. Germs are a fact of life. Yeah. In the meantime, we welcome our affiliation with our new Boston, Massachusetts outlet, FM Talk 96.9. And in conclusion, say with confidence that it is only a matter of time before we give WEEI management and staff a much-needed enema. Okay, boys? Sound off. Enough with civility, courtesy, and class. WEEI, stick it up your ass. Well said, men. The battle is joined. Well, thank you for your attention. That is all.
Here's what we resent, mostly about this little punk Jason Wolfe and Tom Baker, who's two little gnats over there at EEI, is we didn't need them to bring to everybody's attention that, you know, it was over. The I-Man lost his edge, and he was more interested in
right.
his...
The fact that we thought we
annoying
had...
Annoying little children with cancer yeah. and these other people, and yeah, I was, and, you know...
We had quietly permitted that to expire, we thought.
Providing yeah. provocative radio, so...
These morons.
But my enthusiasm for attacking them is diminished because you can imagine if you're the I-Man and being one of the legendary geniuses of modern media, I'm often attacked by people like this.
Well, that's the point.
When they write the history of radio, where do you think somebody like Jason Wolfe or Tom Baker are going to wind up? Well, please.
I don't think it'll be included in a history.
You know, so.
No, catalog of the geniuses. No.
So we'll see what happens with revenue and ratings and let that pretty much decide.
Yes.
IMUS in the Morning, 2020 Sports.
A roller coaster of emotions for a former prodigy. Good morning, Mike Greenwood Sports. This sportscast sponsored by the New Jersey Ice Center. Jennifer Capriati, now 23, was having a terrific tournament at the U.S. Open, reached the fourth round, then lost to Monica Seles. Then lost her composure. After her match yesterday, Capriati said she wanted to close the door on her past, but she read a statement that she had hoped would explain everything once and for all.
Let me say that the path I did take for a brief period of my life was not of reckless drug use, hurting others, but it was a path of quiet rebellion, of a little experimentation, of a darker side, of my confusion in a confusing world. Lost in the mist of finding my identity.
Dark side. Would she have an affair with Darth Vader? But because she didn't give any specifics, reporters pressed her for more, which led to this uncomfortable scene.
Most of you know how hard that can be. When you do it in front of the world, it is even harder. I just wish I didn't have to talk about this stuff all the time.
Well, the most aggressive reporter who harassed her into the tears was allegedly Bud Collins of NBC Sports.
Oh, no,
there
you
go. He was also the reporter at that Ray Hanley press conference years ago, causing the Giants coach to walk out.
I remember.
Just badgered her until finally she started sobbing.
Trying to make his bones.
And had to leave.
Well, I heard him explain himself now from the Boston Globe and NBC Sports.
Yes.
Bud Collins.
Well.
Meanie.
Breen used to be a nice guy. But... Not, well, no, it wasn't I.
No.
But I will tell you a little story. 2 years ago, it was I in Australia when I tried to tell her that so many people want her to succeed. And because a telephone lineman near my house one day stopped me and my wife, he recognized her, and he said, is Jennifer going to make it back? And he said, we really want her to, we love her. And I told her the story at a press conference in Australia, and she broke into tears. And then I told her, I said, I wasn't trying to make you cry. She said, no, I know. But the whole thing is that Jennifer has to get past, she can't get past her past. She wants to put an envelope in an envelope and bury it. It can't be done, because unless you burn up all the research libraries and tapes and everything in the world. What I hope she realizes is that most people care for her transgressions were very minor, for heaven's sakes, not like yours, Mr. Imus. And just go on. And why does she have to keep answering questions? I don't think she does. I think she can smile and say no comment, next question. I think we've gone all through that, and it's tiresome.
What's the point of asking her? I'm going to leave the kid alone.
Well, that's right. I agree with you. But I think she was naive in coming out with this statement saying, let's forget my past. It's there, but nobody cares about it. And that's what I would like to get through to her.
So, we haven't talked to you, of course. It's the first day that U.S. Open is nearly over. And,
yeah, you used to stick around for it, but now you're only here 4 days.
Well,
are you coming out?
No.
Do you still have your box?
Yeah, I do. No, I don't, as a matter of fact. I don't have that. I have my pass, that's it.
Okay.
So,
and you're not going to do a show out there as you usually do?
No, because I can't remember the guy's name. What's the guy running?
Harry Marmion.
No, somebody else.
Jay Snyder.
Yeah, he's a creep. I don't
know. No, I don't think he is.
Yeah, I hate him now.
Oh, do you?
Yeah, well, I don't hate him, but he was not. He was
not forthcoming.
No.
All right.
Sure.
But he's doing a good job out
there.
But anyway.
I don't watch a bunch of dirty foreigners play tennis. I'm sure.
Are you going to beat up on WEEI every day?
No, because, you know, I don't know, 2 weeks or 3 weeks we were
off. You've got to get over it, too.
Lost interest.
No, you're right.
And we'll let the ratings and revenue speak for us, and we'll see how
that's
we do on 96.9.
Well, it'll be interesting. We haven't been home for a long time, but we'll put it on when we get there.
Well, the Barnacle's going to be on. Jay Severin's going to be on his new station.
Look, right? Everybody.
We'll see what happens.
Good.
So, I mean, that's maybe it is over, bud. Maybe I've lost my edge.
Yeah.
Maybe I'm more interested in these annoying children with cancer and my little son and I am with talking about big old thrones on the radio.
We all have to grow up someday.
Yeah, so
could happen.
The ranch is wonderful. We enjoyed it so much.
But I doubt it. I think I'm still an angry person. wants to get even with a lot of people, but not these two little punks because it's irrelevant.
What's the point?
It's not the point.
I think the best thing is not to mention their names.
Andre Agassi, is he going to win this thing?
Well, it's his to lose. I picked him before the tournament began.
Oh,
I just
sure you did. Right. Get out of here. You didn't pick any.
I picked Andre and I picked Venus.
Ooh. We want Venus to punch Martina Hingis in the mouth. Give her a forearm.
Really?
Like, yeah.
Why don't you like Hingis?
Yeah, because she's a loudmouth little jerk.
Well, that's the kind of people that are nice to write about, though.
I know, but... I'd rather see Serena punch her out.
Well, Serena's more able to, I think.
Absolutely,
yeah. She can punch anybody out.
Yeah. So.
My gosh, yes. But today should be good. This Barbara Schett from Austria is a good player, tests Venus. And Hingis goes against Anke Huber. So that's... And on the other side, the most attractive match is Todd Martin, who keeps soldiering on. He's a terrific kid against Greg Rusedski, whom he beat in the Davis Cup in England in April. So it's a good program, but I don't know if we'll ever get it. As I look out the window, it is pretty black.
No.
Pretty black. But the best thing to do out there is to visit the Hall of Fame exhibition in the Louis Armstrong Stadium, which has been remodeled very nicely. They've got some of the great old trophies from back near the turn of the century.
Do they still have a situation there where regular people can't go and that kind of thing?
Well, that is a problem because the Louis Armstrong Stadium is terrific. You can get in there with a grounds pass. It seats 10,000. It's an ideal stadium for tennis. And, yes, the ordinary people can get there.
Oh.
But when you look at Arthur Ashe Stadium, of which Arthur Ashe would not be very proud, if you are an ordinary person, you have a better view of Manhattan than you do of the tennis. You're way up there, Celeste. You've done some bad things.
Well, we hate them all.
You are in a vitriolic mood for a guy who loves little children.
We don't hate you, though.
Thank you.
But that...
Thank you. But tell Breen that I did not make Jennifer cry. I
who
have
did make
done
her?
That, but
who,
I didn't do it yesterday.
Who did make her cry?
I don't know. The question was, do you consider the press always your adversary? I didn't recognize the voice that asked that question, but that started the flood. And it shouldn't
have. Come on. That sounds like Lubica, doesn't it?
No, he wasn't there. He'll be there today.
Oh, he will. Kids.
Yeah. I don't know who it was.
I was supposed to call Lubica back last evening. He called my home. I don't know how he got my home phone number. Maybe I gave it to him in a weak moment. My wife spoke to him for some time, and then I was trying to get Wyatt to behave. And
well, Lubica showed his brilliance, I thought. He's out riding a horse in Montana when he hears that Sampras has dropped out of the Open. And on horseback with his laptop, the horse running away, he managed to write a column, and it was a good column for the Daily News.
Well, I don't know about
you
that.
You sound surly today. I don't know
Let
what it is.
Let me review it. Well,
just a little suspect.
We'll read
all.
The column. We'll
assume. Oh, and it was a long time ago.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it was the first. He was on holiday. The office got hold of him, told him Sampras dropped out, and he had to go. I don't know how he sent it by carrier pigeon or something from deepest Montana.
I know.
But it was a very good column.
How did you send a column, Lubica?
Email.
Or email.
Yeah.
Oh, he's on the phone. Good. I told Bud yesterday he picked Agassi as soon as he saw Sampras clutching his back.
On Sunday before, that's right.
How come he didn't call me back last night? Deirdre said you were taking care of Imus. I said, I have three boys to take care of. She said you were disciplining Imus. Why? What did that mean?
Well, I wasn't disciplining him.
Well, that's exactly what your wife told me.
I know, but I mean, I was just trying to get him to stop hitting me.
Well,
yeah.
You know, the last thing I hear is that you're disciplining Wyatt last night. Then the next, I turn on the show today, and your wife says she's shaking him awake. What the hell's going on there?
About Bill Culp Jr. Ford. They're having their year-end clearance sale. Over 500 new 1999 models must go regardless of cost. Brand new Explorers with 949 SLE package for only $19,995. Price even includes a power sunroof. 1999 Taurus LXs will be sold for only $14,988. 0% financing available there. Bill Culp Jr. dealership exclusive 30-day money-back guarantee. 38 loaner cars available with scheduled service appointments. $1,000 low-price guarantee. They beat all competitive prices. They pay you $1,000. Bill Culp Jr. Ford, Tri-State area's largest Ford dealer, conveniently located on Route 303 in Rockland County. 5 minutes southwest of the Tampa Z Bridge. 15 minutes northwest of the Joe Weisman Bridge. Bill Culp Jr. Ford and Bill Culp Jr. Subaru, Route 303 in Rockland County. It's where that man buys his Ford truck, where you ought to buy yours. Yeah. Call them at 914-359-7777. Bill Culp Jr. Ford, Bill Culp Jr. Subaru. For decades, Rahm and Hammer baking soda has stood for cleaning, whitening, and freshening. Now they have two great-tasting new products to get your teeth cleaner and whiter. There's great-tasting Rahm and Hammer gum. More delicious flavors there. Spearmint, cinnamon, peppermint, and wintergreen. Gum cleans your tooth and freshens your mouth. Baking soda reduces unflaking plaque up to 25%. In 4 weeks, you get your teeth whiter as well. Clinical tests prove it's great for the whole family. You and your kids will love it. It's gum that tastes great and is actually good for you. No wonder it's in the toothpaste style. And now there's new great-tasting Arm & Hammer Advanced White Toothpaste. Imagine what happened to use them both. The gum and the toothpaste. Good God almighty. Arm & Hammer, check it out. Many people here at the radio station have already visited Dr. Joseph Delarusso out at the New Jersey Eye Center. They had the boy zap their eyeballs with this laser deal. Some people were nearsighted, farsighted, or had astigmatism. After a careful evaluation, mostly making sure you had enough on your credit card to cover it, Dr. Delarusso was able to offer each person the appropriate treatment for his or her own personal needs. Well, a little credit card joke there, of course, Dr. Delarusso. That's a wonderful sense of humor. Call the radio station Wine. Dr. Delarusso taking laser vision correction to the next level. Introducing the Flying Spot Laser. Technology for this laser based on the radar tracking system of the Strategic Defense Initiative. 1-800-35-NJI. Call them. Check it out. Get your eyes fixed. The new Flying Spot Laser. Zappy eyeball.
Mike, it's Ed Mills, your insurance agent.
Oh, funny you should call, Ed.
Oh?
Yep.
Driving that train, I'm cocaine. I'm a in the morning.
Healthcare highlight from the Hackensack University Medical Center. Metropolitan Area's preeminent hospital, one of America's best for quality cardiac care surgery, featuring electron beam ultrafast CT. It has a revolutionary new cardiac screening device that can detect coronary heart disease before the symptoms of a heart attack occur. Well, you'd be clutching your chest there, turning your tongue turning green on you. This easily painless test requires no needles or injections, and all the pictures are the harder taking at one or two breath holes. That's what I'm saying. Discover your risk of heart disease at the only hospital in New Jersey that offers ultra-fast CT.
Swing and a miss. He struck him out, and the game is over.
Misery for the Mets. Good morning. Mike Greenwood Sports. Bob Murphy, the call, WFAN. This sportscast sponsored by Cooper Tire. See Sam or Rick at Perth Amboy Tire, 475 Smith Street, Perth Amboy, New Jersey.
Tell them the I-Man sent you.
Yeah.
I'll tell them anything.
Men flew 7-4 to the Giants out at Shea. Manager Bobby Valentine had a simple explanation for this loss.
There isn't a time for inconsistent strike zones. There isn't a time of the year for consistent strike zones. That's what this is all about.
Blame the umps. Those doubles caroming off the outfield wall had nothing to do with it. Inconsistent strike zones. Oh, by Bobby V. Well, Mark McGuire's in a slump. 0 for his last 12 after last night's loss to the Atlanta Braves. And McGuire a little testy when asked about his slump.
I don't understand. I played this game long enough. Why is everybody so worried about me? I played this game long enough. I know what to do. I know how to get myself out of things.
Mark's stuck at 54 home runs right now.
Yeah.
Four behind his former friend Sammy Sosa, who he no longer talks to, according to my sources. Sammy now, of course, has more home runs than Mark, so the friendship isn't there. U.S. Open, great match between Todd Martin and Greg Rusedski. Martin lost the first two sets, but stormed back in 1-5. Rusedski, after the match, lashing out at Martin, claiming Martin's body odor became a factor in the match.
It's just so foul and repugnant. It really makes... I never thought my eyes could burn and sting so badly.
Just some sour grapes from a loser.
That was the woman's locker room.
Out at the U.S. Open. Uh-huh. A good match today, actually, tonight. It's Monica Seles against Serena Williams. Serena once beat Monica a while back. Bud Collins, our ace tennis analyst, predicted a Monica Seles victory, but he also predicted Venus to win the tournament. We shall see.
Yeah. Well, yeah, we will.
So. Should be great.
Compelling.
It's quite
haven't had any take any raw meat out there to keep them all on their various sides of their net, have they?
No, not yet. So.
Of course, the big football weekend coming up. Week one, your New York Jets. And, of course, the Giants, too, playing down in Tampa Bay.
They suck.
Giants will be very good, as will Tampa. Jets one of the favorites to be in the Super Bowl.
Where did the Jets play this week?
New England.
Is that here?
Yeah.
They had a whoop-up on them, right?
You going to go to the game?
Yeah. Yeah, because the game's on television. Why not have the football package on DirecTV? Why would I go to any game?
You take Leon Hess's seat.
Yeah, so... Well, we just talked with Francesa, Breen and I, out in the newsroom off the air, and I was very encouraged. I saw Mike yesterday, and he had broken his big toe on his left foot.
Yeah.
But Parcells rolled over and bent the wrong way.
And,
hey, coach, my toe.
I resent that about my friend, Francesa.
I think he broke my fibula, too.
So we were encouraged because we thought that would affect his golf game. For the
now we could park in those handicap zones, legitimately.
So this is unbelievable, you know. The coach and Francesa, talking about Bill Parcells, the coach of the Jets, they were going to some steak joint out on Long Island, right?
That's correct, yep.
Yeah. And they were parking in a handicap,
right.
You know, so they could don't have to walk that far.
It's like a waddle or shorter distance.
So, because the coach is...
a moose.
The coach is a real moose.
Oh,
whale. Son Francesa actually looked pretty good. He's fat, but he's not huge.
He's a big man.
Yeah, he's a big guy.
Very broad.
He wears it well.
Yeah, yeah. He does. He looks, he's not a hideous looking. Like Parcells has great big old breasts.
Oh, yeah, sure.
I mean, and then a big old...
he needs like a push-up bra.
And Parcells insists on wearing his double knit belt loop pants, you know, that he's just got that big roll that it's just
flows over.
Yeah, it just makes you ill.
Oh, please. So. Sloppy looking.
Yeah. So, but anyway, they were parking in the handicap zone, going in and getting the lip lock on the probably free steaks.
On everything.
Everything, just whatever they could.
Sure.
So anyway, but it turns out that Francesa broke his toe some time ago.
Uh-oh. So it's not affecting him particularly? Or
he says it's not. What did he say to you?
No, he said the same thing.
Okay.
Yeah.
So at least he's consistent in his comment, but he's not going to tell you anything because you're on...
Sure, you're the team.
You and I are on the same team. So.
Your principles.
Yeah.
I'd like to think you'd tell me, be honest with me.
I doubt that.
Playing this gamesmanship stuff.
But, Well, he's going to choke anyway. So
he's your competitor.
Yeah, he's
not to worry about beating him.
That's not going to be a problem. Right. So that's a no. That's nothing. Because he plays golf on a fairly regular basis, and I never play.
I don't think he's played at all this summer.
Yeah.
Remember, he had that surgery on his knee. I don't think he's played once.
God, he's a mess.
When he tees off, just surreptitiously drop a ring ding on the tee.
Oh, we're doing ring ding jokes now?
Are we? You know, throw them off.
We're talking about the big golf match, the Stephen A. Cox Charity Golf Classic, that will be broadcast on MSNBC and on the radio.
Hey, Mike.
And our team consists of me, Breen, Phil Sims, and Mike Lupica. Good morning, Mr. Lupica.
Hi, am I in the air? I want to talk golf.
How's your game?
Stinks.
Really?
Yeah. It's kind of tapered off since I was playing well about a month ago. Then I had a bad collision in the Artist Writer softball game. Who would have thought that an abstract impressionist would block the plate that way? I mean, who knew? But they assure me my hand will be fine soon. Now you're matching these things up like you're the number one guy on our team, and you're faced off against Francesa.
Yeah.
And then Breen has to beat Russo.
Right.
Who do I have to beat?
You have to beat Nance.
Really, do I?
Yeah.
He was on the golf team at Houston. I'm a middle-aged man with four kids and a puppy.
That's fine. You can still beat him. Because Nance is a pansy.
No, he's not. He's a manly boy.
He's not a manly boy.
Huh? No. He probably, you know what he'll do? He'll take his shirt off like Agassi after he wins.
I sort of doubt that. So.
You do?
Yeah. Now, and I think Bobby Mercer, is he on their team?
Mm-hmm. Well, have we gotten a confirmation from Mercer?
He's not on our team. We don't have to worry.
Yeah, we don't care.
Well, what if he doesn't show?
Great.
That's fine with us. I think McCarver's angling to be Mercer's caddy. That's how desperate McCarver is.
Well, because you humiliated him, that's why.
Well, because we don't want him on the team, because he sucks. He's a 20 handicap.
You know what you did? Here's a guy who played in four different decades in Major League Baseball.
Baseball.
And you treated him like the kid you send out to right field in Little League.
Yeah.
Baseball.
Baseball. He played baseball. He didn't play golf. Hear Nolan Ryan this morning?
Yeah.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, how did Terry Bradshaw get a talk show and Nolan Ryan didn't? You know what I'm saying?
I miss in the morning.
The Wiz Labor Day sale rules with hundreds of our site bites.
Bites fast.
The world goes around and around. The sure thing never changed. No, 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 no. The joy of bubbles, joy of fun, joy of Pepsi on your tongue. The greatest day sensation.
Weekend new lower price edition of Mets Dream Week. Take the field in Port St. Lucie in your own authentic Mets uniform next to stars from Mets history. You must be over 30 and willing to leave your cares behind. Call 1-800-888-4376. That's 1-800-888-4376.
Darcy could be.
When a Britney Spears
Eminem could
fake
be ugly.
Pops out.
Yeah. Kid Rock.
Kid Rock.
Kid Rock could get ugly. So. Anyway, here's Scott Meany. Good morning, Scott.
Donald, here backstage at the Metropolitan Opera House where we've had a little more unpleasantness from Joe C., the 40-inch front man for rap ripoff artist Kid Rock, the 23-year-old Mr. C., who objects to any comments having anything to do with his childlike stature, apparently punched a New York City truant officer in the scrotum when the school official, thinking the petite potty-mouth punk was playing hooky and attempted to drag the hood ornament-sized little hood back to a third-grade class at nearby PS 193. I'll tell you, man, that's one angry little dwarf. I haven't seen a midget with an attitude like that since George Stephanopoulos left the White House. On a much lighter note, the fiercely talented Lauryn Hill, who's set to perform live this evening, despite the Italian-American protests against her song Doo-Wop That Thing, was here a bit earlier for soundcheck. Ms. Hill arrived in a white stretch limo, dragging behind which and tied to the rear bumper was former shock jock Doug the Greaseman Tracked. Hobble-dee-dee indeed. So far, the only... What? Are you sure? Can we get... Donald, I'm just waiting for some confirmation here, but apparently the only male in the music industry who has not had sex with Mariah Carey has arrived. Once again, the lone gentleman who has, at least at this moment, not slept with the singing slut is here at Metropolitan Opera House. word with her now. Mr. Mottola? Tommy? Tommy Mottola, Donald, former husband of Mariah Carey. Tommy, can we get a few words from... Okay, apparently he's in a rush. He's either late with that bag of cash for the MTV program director, or he's going over to drag Jennifer Lopez out of Eminem's dressing room. But the magic has already begun backstage here at the Metropolitan Opera House, where tonight the MTV Video Music Awards will take place. I'm going to go take a nitroglycerin pill. This is Scott Beauty. I'm a Santa Martin News.
Now wait a minute.
I'm a in the morning.
Talk to you about Jeep now.
The ball game is over, and we can finally go home and dry off.
A special night in Miami. Good morning. Mike Greenwood Sports, Dave O'Brien, the call, the Marlins Radio Network. The last place Marlins last night played the disappointing Dodgers in Florida. 13-inning game that included three rain delays. The game ending 7.5 hours after the scheduled start. Approximately 200 fans in the stands when the last out was recorded. What a night for baseball. U.S. Open Tennis men's quarterfinals last night. In attendance, Keith Richards, one of the celebrities out there. And he watched Richard Krajicek serve 48 aces, 48 in one match, and he still lost in five sets to Evgeny Kafelnikov, a fifth set, a tiebreaker. He will face Andre Agassi.
Somebody thought there were 49 aces that he'd served, but...
I've seen both numbers.
Yeah.
So somebody's wrong.
Well, the official score, whomever... recorded 48, so.
Maybe we compromise. I'll say 48 and a half.
Maybe we could look at the tape and it would be a good way to tell.
I'll spend the next hour doing that.
Yeah.
Watching the match.
Okay. Keith Richards was...
The official score was in the bathroom doing lines with Keith Richards.
He had something, had two things in his hair, which I...
Troubling?
Probably.
Man. His hair.
I mean, he just did not look well. And John McEnroe was trying to explain to us how much Keith Richards knew about tennis, like that was some accomplishment.
Yeah.
To know something about tennis. I've failed to understand that, by the way. That McEnroe, who I like, by the way, but I mean, they treat us all like if we don't understand the nuances of this idiotic game, then we're somehow that's we're diminished in their analysis and their estimation of our abilities to... He knows a lot more about tennis. What is there to know about it?
I don't know.
Do you? No,
net,
have any idea?
Pretty simple.
Net, court, my side, hit back.
Racket.
Ball.
Lesbians.
I don't know.
Lines.
I'm a in the morning.
CBS Monday, September 20th. When you're the one man.
And writes about it Sunday in the Boston Globe, so check that out.
Good.
It's 18 till the hour.
Pat O'Brien from CBS Sports is here.
Well, it's
very nice to see you again.
No, it's just getting around.
We've got to get you a behavior at the Open.
Why, what app?
That should be your lead story.
It is. Food consumption at Open.
You know,
no longer possible
minute.
After visit by I-Man depletes stores.
I had a couple of hot dogs. God, make a huge
Say,
issue out of it.
First of all, you guys arrived dressed like Johnny Rivers' backup band. Okay. God, you guys look like Martha Stewart at a Green Day concert.
Your radio sounds funny in the morning. You're listening to Imus in the morning.
My wife happens to love me very much, and as well she should. So
big balloon payment.
Yeah, that's a vicious, mean thing to say, Bernard.
How did she decorate the wheelchair access to your apartment?
Imus in the morning.
Years. Wait. Oh, get up, come in, or send Kara or somebody to come in here and get it, and tell me why I have this. I mean, that's insane.
Right.
Anyway, Barnacle.
Yeah.
We're on 96.9, right?
Right. I'm on at 10. You're off at 9:59. I'm going to have the best of George Carlin on this morning.
Is this your first morning?
Yeah, I'm going to have him, George Carlin, Shinga Chavin, you know. All sorts of great people on.
Will you be taking telephone calls?
I don't think so. A couple maybe, but not a lot. I figure anybody who hangs on the line to talk to me doesn't deserve to talk to anybody. They got to be incredible losers if they want to talk to me.
Hang on. Go in and ask Lauren why I have this sheet that is out of date, and here's why it's out of date. That's why it's out of date. Ask her why I have that. Get on the phone to Westwood One and get that fat... bastard Bartolomeo on the phone, ask him why I have this. And go in and ask Bernard why I have it, and why he doesn't check it. And why all of you are not paying attention. I really ought to fire all of them. In fact, you all are fired.
I just decided not to do radio for a living.
Why?
Well, first of all, I'm not doing
doing it for a living. I'm only doing it once a week, but, you know, I mean, it's...
Here's my position. If I did my job the way Bernard does his job, or the way Kara does her job, or Lauren does her job, I'd be fired.
No,
I can't.
You wouldn't.
No, yeah, absolutely I would. I can't do my job the way... I cannot do my job the way they do their job and keep my job.
Yeah, but the problem is you're unfocused. They're not. You are.
No, I'm not unfocused. I know what's going on. I expect to be able to pick up something and have it to be current. That's what I expect.
Oh, man, you're such a... You don't even know how big a loser you are.
You shut up, you moron.
Guess what I'm going to do with the show, Don?
I'm still angry at you over that whole... Why don't I get into this now, but...
What? What are you angry
about?
Well,
you know what I'm angry at you about.
Well, I'll talk to you off the air, young man.
Yeah, you don't talk to nobody
else. I'll come down there and give you a good
ass. You're not
going to
do anything. You're not going to do anything, you old fart. It's 10 minutes till the hour.
I have a couple of ideas I want to bounce off you for the radio show.
I already talked to Carlin. 10 minutes till the hour now.
I'm a in the morning.
I really am irritated about this, Bernard.
I can tell.
No, I mean, I just think it's inexcusable. It is inexcusable. I don't think it is. It is. For decades now, Armin...
Preparation for that for us is Scott Meany. Good morning, Scott. So,
Donald, things have taken a turn for a worse here backstage at the Metropolitan Opera House. The future of the MTV Video Music Awards now appears darker than McCord's mustache. Attempts by medical personnel to separate event host Chris Rock's fingers have failed. Once again, the Johnny Tremaine-type procedure to rectify the annoying paddle-like pose of his hands was unsuccessful. So this evening, he'll continue to make gestures, giving the appearance he is playing ping-pong. Britney Spears arrived just moments ago for sound check, her breast implants preceding her by almost a full 20 minutes. I'm telling you, if she hasn't had a boob job, I'll eat a dead dog's collar.
Yeah.
Speaking of which, Korn's Freak on a Leash video, up for a Viewer's Choice Award, does not, as was initially thought, refer to Dick Morris. I did see Korn earlier. I assume it was the band. I was in the men's room, and quite frankly, it was tough to tell. Carney Wilson will be making a surprise appearance this evening. At least I think it was her. It could be a confused Rosie O'Donnell, who believes she could do for the MTV Awards what she did for the Grammys. Carney, as you know, recently had a medical procedure performed on the Internet. Stomach reduction surgery. I don't know, but if I'm Carney, the thing I think about getting reduced would have to be my ass.
That's fine.
I don't know what the point of stapling her tummy was. She should have had stapled was her hands to the kitchen table so she can't reach for the effing Twinkies. Well, here we go. Dono, as I'm speaking to you, Ruthie, one of the cast members from this year's Real World Hawaii, has arrived. Ruthie, as you may know, has a little substance abuse problem. In fact, forget Mark from Milwaukee. This chick must have the ultimate I-Man obsession, the way she can throw back the vodka. And, yes, she's proving it to us right now. As we speak, Ruthie from the Real World is peeing in the phone booth backstage here at the Metropolitan Opera House. We're covering the MTV Video Music Awards. This is Scott Beauty for Imus in the Morning.
Imus in the Morning.
The Star Ledger is a commuter's best friend.
Patton Jr.
At ease, as you were, people. I am appearing before you fungus-infested excuses for bipedal anthropoids to discuss the subject of leadership, a concept absolutely foreign to most of you lemming-like, lapdog, sheep-sucking sycophants who couldn't wipe your butts without your mamas standing by with Procter & Gamble products. You make me sick! Unlike the individual I am here today to speak about, a figure of unstinting gallantry, guts, and grit, a man of unchallenged fortitude, valor, and principle, a leader, gentlemen, whose qualities of command, initiative, skill, and savvy are forged in steel and set in granite. A man
Jesus, all right, sir.
What was that? Who said that? I will shoot every third person in this debriefing room until the man who said that speaks up. Did you say that, soldier?
Sir, no, sir, sir.
You there, seat two, row seven. Was that your loud mouth?
Sir, no, sir, sir.
How about you, Private? It sounded like it came from right there.
Oh, sir, it wasn't me, sir. It was the private behind me, sir. Yeah, that's it, the ventriloquist.
Thank you, Private. Now then, I'm glad we resolved that before I had to drop everybody in here. Because, after all, I'm here to discuss John McCain, the Arizona senator who is running for the Republican presidential nomination, badly trailing George W. Bush, Jr., and therefore needs every vote he can get, including those of you who, so far, survive here today. I shall proceed. John McCain, son and grandson of Navy admirals, decorated Navy pilot, spent 5 years in communist prisoner of war camps. A man who, when criticized during a campaign for being an outsider, responded memorably, "The longest place I ever lived in was Hanoi." Yeah. This John McCain is running against a pack of pipsqueaks so inferior by comparison, it's laughable. His principal opponent, Junior Bush, is a man distinguished by two facts: his ability to attract money and his inability to recall whether he once started Peru, Colombia, or possibly both. We don't know, because he, perhaps understandably, can't remember. And now, a major event has occurred in this process, indeed, perhaps a watershed moment. Senator McCain has been formally endorsed by Don Imus, the host of this radio program, who has said he intends to ride McCain to the bitter end. Two observations, if I may. At the risk of violating Don't Ask, Don't Tell, I suspect that this isn't the first John the I-Man has ridden. Yeah. And if he does intend to stick with McCain, then the end will indeed be bitter, yeah, with John not only losing the Republican nomination, but also his Senate seat, his home in Arizona, any last vestige of integrity remaining to him, and any possible future source of income. Thankfully, such an outcome is not likely, since, as Imus has demonstrated repeatedly in swearing firm, unswerving allegiance to a political candidate, he always adds the hidden proviso, subject to change without notice. And so, the fight is joined, people. Vote for McCain. Yep. Ignore the Imus endorsement and trust that the senator can overcome its stigma. After all, it could have been worse. Senator McCain could have been endorsed by Jerry Springer. Thank you for your attention. That is all.
Congratulations to Ted Nagel of Fort Wayne, Indiana. He's the winner of Speed Vision Sweepstakes for Fred's restored 1955 Chevy truck being worked on by Keenan and Cleet down there.
Yeah.
Street Rods USA in El Paso, Texas. We had a report on the progress of the restoration.
Oh, good.
It's Keenan. Good morning, Keenan.
Good morning, Don. How are you?
I'm fine. How are you?
I'm doing just fine.
So now, you and Cleet, does Cleet actually work, or your dad, does he actually work on these trucks? Or?
Yes, he does. When he's not traveling up there to Santa Fe and back. But, yeah, he does quite a bit of work.
I know.
Yeah.
So, what is the... you guys built this 55 Cameo for me.
Right.
It took some time to...
Yes, it did, but the quality was well worth waiting for.
Yes, it was. There you go. Even though you can't tell how fast you're going. For some reason.
That does create a problem.
Where are we now? What can Tim Nagel out there in Fort Wayne, Indiana, expect?
Tim can expect a great red 55 Chevy pickup.
Ooh. Oh, okay.
It's a beautiful red pickup.
When?
When? The agreed-upon completion date was January 1st.
Oh, it is?
Yes. And but I believe we'll be done sooner than that. But it'll be done for sure by the end of this year.
Oh, it will?
Oh, sure it will.
Well, Y2K truck.
No. Dreamer never got it right. Died and lived in color.
Fan Highway Patrol.
Baby, you gotta love it. Imus in the Morning, 2020 Sports.
Jaha puts a fastball hard to center field, but Lewis going back. Now he can't get to it. It bounces to the wall. Here comes one run in. Here comes Velarde to the plate. He'll score. And intercepted is Jaha with a double.
A wild race for the wild card. Good morning, Mike Greenwood Sports. Bill King the call, KABL Radio in Oakland. With the Athletics beat the Red Sox 6-2, this sportscast sponsored by Kaplan Testing.
So I just get a call from a friend of mine who wants to know if I have any tickets to the U.S. Open.
Yeah.
And, which is something Breen asked me, I believe.
Right.
No. A few days ago.
I just asked you if you still had your box.
No. And the answer is no to both questions.
Okay.
No, I don't.
Nor do you want any.
No.
Nor do I want any.
Right.
No, God.
That's over.
That is just so over.
Oh, what happened? You used to be so into it.
Well, it's just, I got disenchanted with them.
Yeah.
It's just, the new stadium bummed me out.
Mm-hmm.
The new stadium is just awful.
You change hot dog vendors?
they really ruined it with the new stadium.
Yes.
And,
great name, bad stadium.
Yeah. So, not a good stadium.
I must look like Keith Richards goes out.
Oh, please.
And Keith Richards out there last night for some inexplicable reason.
Well, because he knows the game so well.
We're being informed by Mr. McEnroe on USA that of how much Keith Richard knows about tennis, and I'm thinking, as he's saying that, what is there to know, period? I mean,
not a real complicated undertaking.
I mean, you either have the ability to play, and obviously there's, I mean, obviously there's strategy and all of that. Mm-hmm. I mean, it goes without saying, but, well, I mean, as an average fan, you don't need to know all of that.
No, you don't.
But, and you don't need to be denigrated because you don't. Because it's irrelevant. It's useless information.
Absolutely.
That,
right.
Unless you're a player.
It's a slather. Wasn't Keith Richards a player? Didn't he wasn't he a qualifier at Wimbledon one year?
It's not. Mike Breen continues.
Interrupting the crickets, Mike.
A's and Red Sox battling for the wild card in the American League. After last night's result, Red Sox lead the A's by 3 games. But Boston with a bizarre decision for last night's game. Amazingly, they allowed the A's to have more than 3 outs in some of the innings. Starter and loser Pat Rapp did not agree with the decision.
It's just a team you can't give 4 or 5 outs an inning to. In a couple of innings, we gave them extra outs.
I agree with Rapp. I don't know if they were trying to play mind games or what, but it's a ridiculous decision by the Boston Red Sox.
Right.
Speaking of the tennis situation, here now covering part of it is Mike Lupica, the New York Daily News sports writer and nationally syndicated sports columnist and frequent guest on the ESPN Sports Reporters with that fat loser, Dick Schaub.
Why do you always have to call him a fat loser? He's not fat.
He's a fat hog and a loser.
therefore...
Hi, is this John McEnroe? This is Pete Sampras calling from California.
That was the highlight of that coverage last night, wasn't it?
But the best thing was, I mean, that was a call they would have dumped out on here on the overnight show, you know? And they stayed with it for about what seemed like 3.5 hours.
I was hoping it was a Howard Stern fan, frankly. that would jerk him around there for about 20 minutes and then do a Baba Booey thing and hang up.
But
how's your penis?
What'd you say?
I said, how's your penis? Not your penis, but I mean...
You're asking about mine or Pete's?
No, Pete's.
Well, I think it's fine. I don't think that was the injury that kept him out of the open, frankly.
Did McEnroe get a commitment, did you think, for him?
No, absolutely not.
No, of course not.
No. No, I don't think that's an Imus McCord relationship right there.
They don't like each other?
Why
would he call in then?
Well, because I think somebody got him to call in, and he's out there, and he's lying around on his back, and he's bored.
Oh, I see.
But I don't think Pete, I mean, if you listen to the conversation, I don't think Pete committed to anything last night.
Oh. Does he not like McEnroe?
I don't think Pete is crazy about playing Davis Cup, and I don't think he likes to commit to doing it 3 or 4 times a year. But I think that if anybody can get him to do it, McEnroe can.
Sure.
Because I think these guys are going to think for 1 year it's a cool thing to play for them.
Well, it's about as bad as that conversation was last night.
Really, this really is. If it were not 7 minutes to 10 o'clock Eastern time.
Can you say Baba Booey?
Can you say how's your penis? Can you say anything?
Anything.
No, I don't want to. I don't want to play on your team anymore. You know what? Let me tell you something. You're the captain of that team.
No.
And maybe I'll play, maybe I won't play.
No, you'll play.
Oh, maybe I will, maybe I won't.
No, you'll play. You're going to play.
If I don't play, what happens?
And let me tell you something else, you little shrimp. Not only are you going to play, you're going to bogey, you're going to birdie 2 holes of the 3.
You think this is the way McEnroe's going to try to inspire the Davis Cup guys?
Probably fairly similar, yeah.
Just...
What happened?
It's over, Mike.
Bye-bye, love. Bye-bye, happiness. Hello, loneliness. I think I'm gonna cry. Bye-bye, love. Bye-bye, sweet caress. Hello, emptiness. I feel like I could die. Bye-bye, my love. Goodbye.
I miss in the morning.
Welcome on.
CBS Radio. All rights reserved. Amos in the Morning is a presentation of WFAN and Westwood One Entertainment. Go, baby.
This concludes the entertainment and revenue-generating portion of your broadcast day. We now return you to the rest of your local programming schedule, an indecipherable embarrassment of broadcasting incompetence that compelled the station to subscribe to the Imus in the Morning program in the first place. The entertainment and revenue-generating portion of the broadcast day, the Imus in the Morning program, will resume tomorrow morning. Check your local listings for time and schedule.
Every day, keep your radio locked in to the Fan. Sports Radio 66, WFAN New York, an Infinity Broadcasting Station. WFAN 2020 Sports.
Good morning. It is 10 o'clock. I'm Joe Tolleson, the Yankee.
I was assured that this is going to be...
What?
A yuck tsunami by...
Absolutely. Very appropriate.
Yeah. 22 after the hour here in the Imus in the Morning program. Well, I should pick these games as well, shouldn't I?
Well, yeah.
The Jets will beat the Patriots. Buccaneers will beat the Giants. The Packers will beat the Raiders.
Mm-hmm.
The Bills will probably beat the Colts. The Redskins Well, that's a tough. That's some Cowboys could win.
Cowboys got a good quarterback.
Could win that game.